With Bleach literally around the corner in less than a month, we have some big things coming towards July as a whole, and we're going to be talking about all those in today's episode, because we're going to be talking about episode 14 of Bleach, because we have the episode synopsis of that I'm going to break down. We have Bleach Brave Souls entering its 8th anniversary, and we're going to do a reaction to that and a little bit of thoughts on that in regards to, well, I saw Aaron's video, and to be quite honest, he's just wrong in everything that he ever says about any anniversary, so there's that. Not that I'm any better, but there you go. We're going to be talking about Can't Fear Your Own World, and we're going to be talking about something that I've been promoting quite a bit recently that isn't quite relevant to this video, but also Project Blade and a little bit about that as well. So if you're new here, click that like and subscribe button. And if you're already a fan, click that like and share it around with all your friends and family. With that being said, let's get into it. So as I said, Bleach is coming literally around the corner, and we already have episode 14, its title and its synopsis. I'm going to talk about this, break it down a little bit, and then give you my overall thoughts in general. So first and foremost, this episode is going to be releasing on July 8th, which again, literally around the corner, and this episode is going to be called The Last 9 Days. Is this going to be another 13 episode core? Who knows? We'll have to wait and see. I'm going to assume so, that is the case. But the synopsis reads, and again, I translated this myself, so it's going to be a little bit sketch, but you'll probably get the kind of all gist of it. And if you also know as well from the synopsis, it always kind of gives you a synopsis at the start of the episode rather than the whole episode as it is. So also take that within a pinch of salt as well. But of course, I will always keep doing the episode previews as well when the anime is coming out as well. So of course, if you like these, of course, hit that subscribe button. So let's get into it. Ichigo tries to return to the Seireite from the royal palace, but Hayasube stalls him, as known as Ichibei, saying that he can't win against Yuha Bar if he doesn't change his ways. At the Vandenreich, Sturmritters stand up in a row and Yuha Bar nominates his successor. On the stage appears the last remaining Quincy, Uryu Ishida, the last survivor of the world. The sudden turn of events causes tension within the Order, and Baz B, unable to hide his dissatisfaction, takes a swipe at Hushwold, and Uryu himself also questions Yuha Bar. Maybe poor translations from me, but there's the overall kind of scope of things anyway. And, you know, this pretty much goes with how the Last 9 Days chapter pretty much goes out throughout and is pretty much bang on point. So if you want to go read that chapter, chances are you're going to pretty much get what that chapter gives, except maybe some changes here and there in regards to the backgrounds that we saw in, like, the PV instead of a corridor. Maybe on like this whole table of knights that we see within the PV. But one thing does interest me the most, which is a slight change, which seems to be that Hayasube Ichibei tells Ichigo that he basically can't win against Yuha unless he doesn't change his ways. And this is interesting, because I do believe, and I have to go back, because I haven't, I'm going off the dome, but this is probably setting up for the new extra content where we see within the PV of Ichigo kind of training himself, especially with like that wooden sword that he's got, and you know, all those different lights surrounding him, and he looks like he's in that shrine area. And that seems to be what this is leading up to, is that Ichigo's actual training process that we never really got into the manga. And it's good that Ichibei kind of tells him this, rather than the manga just giving him like his swords and then taking him straight down to the Soul Society as it is. So it's good to get that little bit of context, and it's good to see that this episode is setting up towards that and gives us a little bit more of an explanation or exploration of Ichigo's character, which is fantastic. And I'm glad that we're getting this from first episode, that we're going to get to see new scenes, new content right off the get-go. And it seems that this whole core going into core 3 and 4 is leading up to what we're going to be experiencing with new content in general. It really has already set the boundaries. Core 1 has pretty much for the majority of the part been very canon to what we see in the manga, which we expected. And I'll talk a little bit more about canonicity of some things, especially going into Can't Fear Your Own World shortly. But in Core 2, we're going to start to see those dramatic shifts of original versus new, which is being the anime. And again, this is a good thing, and I'll explain why shortly. So that's the overall episode synopsis of episode 14. Again, I can't wait to see this. We're probably going to hear some things in regards to the pre-screening of episode 14 and 15 that many lottery winners are going to get to experience on June 25th. So hopefully there's some kind of leaks that go on there. And the only thing I'm really interested in is in the Bambietta scene, because I think many people are going to ask, do you know about the Bambietta scene? I actually don't, and it's frustrating because I need to know. I say I'll drop Bleach if they don't incorporate it, but I'll still watch it. But still, like, come on, add the Bambietta scene, man. It's important to Bambietta's character. It gives all of these characters, you know, a bit of time to shine, and people are going to say, oh, well, you know, they got rid of fan service. The Bambietta scene isn't really fan service. It's to kind of demonstrate what type of character Bambietta is and adds to it, as well as like the reactions from the Bambi girls right after that scene. It gives them a bit of personality as well. So I do think that it's not really, you know, fan service, but I feel like they're going to move it around. But again, I'm going to keep up the hopium. Inject it in my veins, please. So as I just said, let's talk about Can't Feel Your Own World as well, because I don't know what numbskull said this or spread this around. I don't know if it was a YouTube thing or whether it was a Twitter thing, whether it was a Reddit thing. I don't know where it came from, right? Unfortunately, the rumors going around that, you know, the Thousand Year Blood War arc is going to be wrapped up by Core 3, and then Core 4 is literally going to be about the Can't Feel Your Own World, which is absolutely ridiculous because, again, they're two completely different IPs. This IP is called the Thousand Year Blood War arc, and they've said that all these cores, in interviews before the anime even came out, they said that all these cores are going to be telling the Thousand Year Blood War arc from start all the way to finish. Now, of course, you can speculate and question, does that include the final chapter? That is a question. I will give you that. That is. But in regards to the new content that we're going to be getting, it's ridiculous to say, because again, you're conflicting two IPs. Then let's just say we're going to have Ruki's wedding of We Do Not Always Love You at Core 4 too. Oh, but you don't want that, but you want Can't Feel Your Own World. It's like, make up your mind, because all these things happen before the last chapter. So no, I do think the majority of Thousand Year Blood War arc is going to be literally everything until that final chapter. And the reason why I say this as well, because I do believe the manga volume for chapter 74 was also back to orange instead of red in the manga volumes. But again, I'm being very specific. And I'll just tell you why. I guess because everyone saw Tokinada within the PV, that they assume that Can't Feel Your Own World is going to be in Core 4, which again is ridiculous. Because the reason it is ridiculous is because during the interview in 2013, Kubo had so many ideas, and he also said that this arc is going to be longer than the Arrancar arc or the Waco Mundo arc, as some might say. And some might even split up the arcs as different, but regardless of what, and that was like a 7-year arc. Kubo never managed to even get the 7 years out of Thousand Year Blood War, because due to health reasons and many other factors within his personal life, that just didn't make Bleach last that long. And with all these things that were scrapped and all these rushed endings that we got, which is the main complaint about the Thousand Year Blood War arc, you find that a lot of the ideas that are going to be jam-packed within the Thousand Year Blood War arc anime is ideas that Kubo never got to implement within the manga, which is something we all wanted. And considering that this is going to be longer than the Waco Mundo arc or the Los Noches arc or the Uwankar arc, whatever you want to call it, it speaks volumes that this is going to be going on for four cores, especially with the speed that they're going and especially with the added content that they're adding as well. Oh, well, what about Shinji? There's nothing within the light novels that said that this was the first time that Shinji had ever used his Bankai. If we want to have that conversation once Hisage uses his in the Thousand Year Blood War arc, then sure, right? Because then it would be a retcon, right? Then it would be a bit of an issue. Other than that, Shinji doing Bankai, it completely makes sense, and it is viable because it is stated that he does do it at some point within the Thousand Year Blood War arc. So all these things are interconnecting, you know? These things about Tokinada getting the sword, these things about Shinji using his Bankai, these are all past references from Can't Feel Your Own World into the Thousand Year Blood War arc, because they happened within the Thousand Year Blood War arc. We just didn't get to see them, right? So being able to foreshadow or reference something in the Thousand Year Blood War arc and actually happening in the Thousand Year Blood War arc is a good thing. It doesn't mean it has to coincide with Can't Feel Your Own World, especially if you're building up this thing for Tokinada for something possibly in the future, as well as, you know, what, you're going to have a Can't Feel Your Own World anime after the Thousand Year Blood War arc and then just be told that Tokinada went to Namaya's, like, basement thing under the big river, the big lake thing, and then not get shown it, but randomly get shown it, like, at that time when Can't Feel Your Own World's anime is going. No, it'd be nice to get hinted to these things. And again, we're going back and forth on this idea, but no, there's no concrete evidence at all that Can't Feel Your Own World is going to be in Can't Feel Your Own World is going to be in Core 4 at all. And whoever is spreading this message should stop, because that's not how IPs work. That's not how the director or, you know, the author has said. Nothing has been concretely said, and it's ridiculous, right? Because there's nothing leading to that at all. So let's stop this notion that Can't Feel Your Own World is going to be in the Thousand Year Blood War arc, besides some references of things that actually happened within that war, right? Let's just, if we want to discuss about it, and I'll say I'm wrong if I get proven wrong, but it is ridiculous, and we should stop with this notion. Then let's talk about Bleach Brave Souls, the 8th anniversary. I'm so happy for Bleach Brave Souls. It has made a statement within the Bleach community for years, and without Bleach Brave Souls, we wouldn't even maybe even have an anime at this point. And it's done some amazing things in terms of milestones, and I think the 8th anniversary is definitely one of those where I think even if you like the game or don't like the game, you can't take away its credits on what it's done. Regardless of if there's been problems in the past, it's definitely done some amazing things for the community in general. And it's 8th anniversary, and of course with these 8th anniversaries or anniversaries in general, we always get a teaser, sometimes even a trailer, and then maybe a trailer on the day. But regardless of what, we have a teaser trailer, and as you can see on screen, it's interesting because it is probably the shortest PV. And of course, I've watched all my friends, Aspite, you know, and Aaron talk about, you know, this PV and who they think it is. And for me personally, I'm seeing a bit of a pattern, and that pattern is going to be a bit of against the grain. And what my general thoughts on who the characters are going to be, obviously, time and time and time again, we always get an Ichigo. This is a non-questionable fact, and it seems like we are going to be getting Ichigo this one, because it does look like a Getsuga Jujisho, and of course it looks like Karakura Town. Now again, we could argue for something else. Of course there's Rain, Everything But the Rain. We've got all these speculatory things to go off of, and I'm going to be pretty simple in my prediction, because I do think it is fairly simple. Regardless of what of the Ichigo and the Getsuga Jujisho, let's talk about the colours, let's talk about the environment, let's talk about what we get within the trailer, which is, first and foremost, yellow slashes, right, which is synonymous with Ichigo's this new spiritual energy within the anime, which is what BBS is now following the colour scheme of the Thousand Year Blood War arc, or its proper colours, so to say. Now we have Karakura Town. Now, we can say it was Rukia, because obviously the rain, you know, Karakura Town, but it seems that somebody is fighting somebody, and we know one of them is Ichigo. So it also seems that throughout all the other trailers, it seems that we have antagonists so far to some degree. You know, first we had Okiora, Aizen. Uryu was an antagonist at some point as well, so Uryu's involved in that. We have Byakuya. Now, of course, you could say Grimmjow, but it doesn't look like Grimmjow in this certain case. It could be, obviously, the 9th anniversary, and I do probably think Grimmjow will probably be next to come. But I do believe, because this is Karakura Town, I'm going to go for Ginjo, because it does seem to follow that pattern of people that Ichigo has fought, especially considering of the area of which is in, and it's raining too, you know, when Ichigo lost his powers and it started raining and he was crying. And of course as well, Ginjo could also have the yellow Ryatsu slices as well, or slashes. Now people are going to try and debunk me and say, oh, Ginjo's already had a unit, and that's fine, I will take that in consideration. I'm for Ginjo currently as it stands. But then there's the other one, which is White. Now people are saying, oh well, this is going to be Memories in the Rain, and of course you could say Isshin and you could say White. This is plausible. Again, Isshin kind of has the same inheritance of Getsuga or Tenzo Zangetsu or Zangetsu or whatever you want to call it, right, as Ichigo. Like, we know this, Kubo's kind of said in his Club Outside interviews that yes, like, there is some Zanpakutos that are hereditary. So yes, this could be an Isshin. It just generally really could. I'm more on the side of White, and the reason why I say White, and again, Aaron will argue with me for the sake of arguing, right, but he'll say, oh well, it's called White and not, you know, Tenzo Zangetsu or White Ichigo. And again, we're playing with semantics of names, I guess you could say, right? But White is White, right? So the reason why I am saying this, oh, well, Ichigo's his inner world looks like skyscrapers, but if you look at when he was trying to learn Mugetsu when fighting Aizen, his world was actually very city-like, and the skyscrapers weren't there as much as they previously was. And considering that, like, this is a kind of darkish color and there's a lot of rain, and Zangetsu always talks about how he hates the rain, it would seem as well that it's synonymous with, you know, Ichigo fighting White or Ichigo fighting Tenzo Zangetsu. And again, that's plausible. Zangetsu could be, but I don't think he's on the list. So it could be White. So we have at least three contenders here. We got, you know, obviously Ichigo, but we got Ginjo and White. And the least likely on my head or my list is Isshin. But the reason why I also say Ginjo as well is because this would be a great opportunity for BBS to incorporate what Ginjo would actually look like within his Shinigami actual gear, right? When he was actually a Shinigami. This would be great to add in that in-canon dynamic of what, you know, Ginjo could do. It gives an interest factor. It gives a pull factor for Ginjo. Something that isn't really incorporated in the manga or anime, or something you can really kind of show within those forms of medium. So this would be the great reason to, is you got Ichigo in his true Shikai, and then you've got Ginjo in his true Shinigami outfit and his abilities. So this would be a great example for him to really come through. So that's kind of my prediction. Ginjo, then White, then at the very bottom, Isshin. And let's see if I'm wrong. I probably am, but still better than Aaron's. It just is. I mean, no Rurouka, but hey, maybe next year. It's going to be grim jail. But anyway. And then to end it all off, and I just want to throw this in there because I have been promoting Project Blade for quite a while. It is a game that I've been working with. You know, I'm not going to say I've worked a lot on with at all, but it is something that I've been reached out to. I've seen the gameplay. I've seen the trailer that will be releasing soon. So that's going to be very exciting for you guys to see. And I just wanted to give a little bit of context that this is a project that is going to be exciting for people. And I do want people, you know, to have the opportunity to go try out the alpha. So, of course, there's going to be a link in the description to my Twitter account, which, of course, if you haven't followed, go follow it. But also, you click on the Discord link and you join and then you fill out the form and then you get a chance to be a part of the alpha. But, of course, yes, there's many people going to say, oh, well, this is AI art. And yes, the art seems to be AI. But you have to take into consideration, you're not going to do art for something that is, you know, just something that's going to be temporary. You know, this is a temporary placeholder for that art. And it's supposed to be unrecognizable to what the project actually is. So just because it's AI art doesn't mean I'm promoting something dodgy or silly, right? This is actually a famous anime IP that you guys are really going to enjoy. I'm pretty sure you can put two and two together. And I've seen the trailer, I've seen the gameplay, and it looks gas, man. It looks mad gas. And other people are going to say, oh, well, it's for mobile. It might be for PC too. I think they might have talked about it within their Discord group about it being on PC. I'm not going to confirm nor deny, but I'm just going to say, let's stop the stigma with mobile games. Like back in the day when BBS came out, yeah, there was a bit of a stigma and it is, you know, oh, it's a mobile game, right? But truth be told, most mobile games are beating out some higher class console games. I mean, look at Star Rail, look at Genshin Impact. Those games look absolutely fantastic. The models, the world, the graphics, they look amazing. So I think we're kind of past the idea that mobile phones aren't the gaming platforms, but they are actually becoming the gaming platforms. Some of them are stronger than Switches. Some of them questionably might be like have higher graphical powers than some PlayStations, especially our PlayStation 3s or 4s in this current era. So, I mean, let's not brush it off to the side. And, you know, I hope that you guys get the time to check out Project Blade because it is something that I am promoting. You know, I have signed a NDA for it. So there is like a conflict of interest, like not a conflict, but an interest here, obviously for me, but I wouldn't push something as hard as I am if I didn't believe in this product. And I do think that when you guys see the trailer, you are going to be like, yo, James was spitting. And I'd be like, I know, and you keep doubting me. But with that being said, I hope you enjoyed the video. There's going to be some mad things coming out within the next few weeks and this month in general. And I'm excited for Bleach to come back. So it's been a long while. I hope there isn't that much of a gap between, you know, Core 2 and Core 3. But at the same time, I kind of want there to be because these fights are going to get more and more intense. And yeah, I'm so excited. So with that being said, I'm going to catch you guys. Like you guys, of course, have this fine day. I've been Hanson. And as always, people, peace out.